about any time. So, watch your quick reading. Good for the bad sale. Check. Check it.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that, being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. And so let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
And for the little aisle here, down this way, I'll be blessing everybody. And as I come back, I'll be blessing everybody on the other side.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus and the disciples drew near Jerusalem and came to the Bethphage of the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass tethered and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them here to me. And if anyone should say anything to you, reply, 'The master has need of them.' Then he will send them at once." This happened so that what had been spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. "Say to daughter Zion, 'Behold, your king comes to you, meek and riding on an ass, and on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had ordered them. They brought the ass and the colt and laid their cloaks over them, and he sat upon them. The very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and strewed them on the road. The crowds preceding him and those following kept crying out and saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowds replied, "This is Jesus the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace.
Hosanna to the Son of David. Oh, blessed is he, oh, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna,
Hosanna
to the Son of David.
Hosanna.
Oh, blessed is he.
Hosanna,
Hosanna,
Hosanna.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, those in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Proclamation of the Gospel this morning, we invite you to follow along in the booklet entitled Passion According to Matthew and join in the parts marked with a capital C as the crowd. The Passion of our Lord Jesus according to Matthew. One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that time on he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples approached Jesus and said,
"Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He said,
"Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time draws near. In your house I shall celebrate the Passover with my disciples.'"
The disciples then did as Jesus had ordered and prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at table with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me."
Deeply distressed at this, they began to say to him one after another,
"Surely it is not I, Lord."
He said in reply,
"He who has dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes, as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
Then Judas's betrayer said in reply,
"Surely it is not I, Lord."
He answered,
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took bread and said the blessing, broke it, and giving it to his disciples, said,
"Take and eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on I shall not drink this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in the kingdom of my Father."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"This night all of you will have your faith in me shaken, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him in reply,
"Though all may have their faith in you shaken, mine will never be."
Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
Peter said to him,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And all the disciples spoke likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took along Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee and began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me."
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying,
My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will.
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
So you could not keep watch with me for 1 hour. Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again.
My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done.
Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand.
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a large crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests and elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged a sign with them, saying,
The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him.
Immediately he went over to Jesus and said,
Hail, Rabbi.
And he kissed him. Jesus answered him,
Friend, do what you have come for.
Then, stepping forward, they laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. And behold, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand to the sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then how would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
Have you come out as against a robber, with swords and clubs, to seize me? Day after day I sat in the temple area, and yet you did not arrest me. But all this has come to pass, that the writings of the prophets may be fulfilled.
Then all the disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and elders were assembled. Peter was following him at a distance as far as the high priest's courtyard, and going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward who stated,
This man says, I can destroy the temple of God and in 3 days rebuild it.
The high priest rose and addressed him,
Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
I order you to tell us under oath before the living God whether you are the Christ, the Son of God.
Jesus said to him in reply,
You have said so, but I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his robes and said,
He has blasphemed. What further need have we of witnesses? You have now heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?
They said in reply,
He deserves to die.
Then they spat in his face and struck him, while some slapped him, saying,
Prophesy for us, Christ. Who is it?
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came over to him and said,
You too were with Jesus the Galilean.
But he denied it in front of everyone, saying,
I do not know what you are talking about.
As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there,
This man was with Jesus the Nazarene.
Again he denied it with an oath.
I do not know the man.
A little later the bystanders came over and said to Peter,
Surely you too are one of them, even if your speech gives you away.
At that, he began to curse and to swear,
I do not know the man.
And immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken, Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. He went out and began to weep bitterly. When it was morning, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying,
I have sinned in betraying innocent blood.
They said,
What is that to us? Look to it yourself.
flinging the money into the temple, he departed and went off and hanged himself. The chief priests gathered up the money, but said,
"It is not lawful to deposit this in the temple treasury, for it is the price of blood."
After consultation, they used it to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why that field, even today, is called the Field of Blood. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of a man with a price on his head, a price set by some of the Israelites, and they paid it out for the potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, who questioned him.
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
Jesus said,
"You say so."
And when he was accused by the high priests and chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many things they are testifying against you?"
But he did not answer him one word, so the governor was greatly amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release the crowd one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had assembled, Pilate said to them,
"Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus called Christ?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that they had handed him over. While he was still seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man. I suffered much in a dream today because of him." The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. The governor said to them in reply,
"Which of the two do you want me to release to you?"
They answered,
"Barabbas."
Pilate said to them,
"Then what shall I do with Jesus called Christ?"
They all said,
"Let him be crucified."
But he said,
"Why, what evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder,
"Let him be crucified."
When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all, but that a riot was breaking out instead, he took water and washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourselves."
And the whole people said in reply,
"His blood be upon us and upon our children."
Then he released Barabbas to them, but after he had Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped off his clothes and threw a scarlet military cloak about him. Weaving a crown out of thorns, they placed it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They spat upon him and took the reed and kept striking him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a Cyrenian named Simon. This man they pressed into service to carry his cross. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they gave Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he refused to drink. After that, they had crucified him. They divided his garments by casting lots, and then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And they placed over his head the written charge against him, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself if you are Son of God, and come down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him and said,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. So he is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusted in God. Let him deliver now if he wants him. For he said, I am the Son of God."
The revolutionaries who were crucified with him also kept abusing him in the same way. From noon onward, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at about 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"This one is calling for Elijah."
Immediately, one of them ran to get a sponge. He soaked it in wine and, putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. But the rest said,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to save him."
But Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit.
Please stand.
And behold, the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, rocks were split, tombs were opened, and the bodies of many saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming forth from their tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. The centurion and the men with him who were keeping watch over Jesus feared greatly when they saw the earthquake and all that was happening, and they said,
"Truly, this was the Son of God."
There were many women there, looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was himself a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in a clean linen and laid it in his new tomb that he had hewn in the rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance to the tomb and departed. But Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained sitting there facing the tomb. The next day, the one following the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
"Sir, we remember that this impostor, while still alive, said, 'After 3 days I will be raised up.' Give orders, then, that the grave be secured until the third day, lest his disciples come and steal him and say to the people, 'He has been raised from the dead.' This last impostor would be worse than the first."
Then Pilate said to them,
"The guard is yours. Secure it as best as you can."
So they went and secured the tomb by fixing a seal to the stone and setting the guard. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, not to worry, my homily is only about a half hour long, so. No, just a brief word as we enter into Holy Week, right? In this time leading up to the Passion, the holiest week of our year, the most important part of our year as we remember the suffering, the death, and the resurrection of Christ. And, you know, it's fascinating to me that as we were going through this gospel, there was a line in it that I've heard I don't know how many hundreds of times and never really gave much thought to. It's right as, so Jesus has just been condemned, and he's standing there before Pilate, and Pilate washes his hands. He says, "I'm innocent of this man's blood," which, first of all, just isn't true, right? He's the only one with authority to put Jesus to death, right? And you can't put the man to death and say, "Well, that's not my fault," right? It is his fault. But it's also not true in another way. Because Jesus is dying for Pilate the same way that he's dying for you. Right? Pilate isn't innocent. Pilate isn't sinless. And it's his sins that it's Jesus' love for Pilate that allows Jesus to go to the cross. But and it's right after that there's this line, and I believe it was a line of the crowd. And after Pilate washes his hands, he says, "I'm innocent of this man's blood." The response is, "His blood be on us and on our children." And that's such a fascinating phrase. And it's fascinating to me because they meant something very specific. What they meant is that we'll take the full weight of the guilt, right? Because we're convinced that this man is like a common criminal and whatever, and we just want to get rid of him. And so we'll bear the full brunt of that. But what I find fascinating about that is that that's now a prayer, and it's a prayer that I say myself a lot. His blood be upon me. Right? Because I know, and I know deep in my bones, that I have no hope outside of the blood of Christ. None. Because just like I might want to say the same as Pilate. I'm innocent of this man's blood. It isn't true. I am not innocent. Jesus goes to the cross for me. And without it, without his blood covering me, I am dead in my sins, and I have no hope. But because of his blood, because of the sacrifice that he makes for me, all of my hope is not just restored, but it's elevated. I become something more than I ever could have been, ever thought to even ask for. Right? It's only by and through his blood that I become a son of God. I become an heir to the very throne of his kingdom. His blood be upon me. And so as we enter into this Holy Week, what I think is important to remember is that Jesus doesn't see things or do things in vague, general ways. Right? Jesus doesn't die for humanity, or he doesn't die for the Jews, he doesn't die for the Christians, he doesn't die for, say, Mary Magdalene, he dies for you. Specifically, intentionally, and purposefully, you were on his mind in this moment. Because he knows you're not innocent of his blood. And he knows that without his blood covering you, you have no hope. And that love that he had not for us, but for you and you and you and you and me, not in some vague general way, but specifically, particularly, he chooses to give up all of his blood and allow it to cover you and you and you and me. This is the God that we have. And so as we enter into this Holy Week and as we remember the sacrifices that he makes for you, right, let's not be afraid and let's not be ashamed to take that same word, and let's mean something very different, right? We don't want the full weight of guilt. That's not what we mean, the way that the crowd had said that line. But let's use that and let's take that as our prayer. I'm saying that that's where all of our hope lies. That's where all of our salvation lies. Lord, let his blood be on me. And let those who've been chosen for the Easter sacraments please come forward with their sponsors. My dear friends, listen carefully to the words of that faith by which you will be justified. Hear the wonderful deeds of God for the salvation of humanity and receive this creed with a sincere heart and be faithful to it. I invite the congregation to please rise. Together, as one family of faith, we profess our belief in God. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us pray. Lord, our God, you created us in love and redeemed us in mercy through the blood of your Son. Enlighten these men and women by your grace, that clearly seeing their sins and failings, they may place all their trust in your mercy and resist all that is deceitful and harmful. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, whose love reaches out in mercy to embrace and heal the contrite of heart, lead these candidates along the way of holiness and heal the wounds of their sins. May they ever keep safe in all its fullness the gift your love once gave them and your mercy now restores, for you are Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
My dear friends, this community now sends you forth to reflect more deeply upon the Word of God, which you have shared with us today. Be assured of our loving support and prayers for you. We look forward to the day when you will share fully in the Lord's table.
We walk by faith and not by sight. Oh, gracious words for you. Oh, givers spoke as others spoke.
Together as one family of faith, let us bring to our Heavenly Father our prayers and petitions.
For the Pope's April intention that by decreasing the use of weapons by states and citizens, we will spread a culture of peace and nonviolence, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For greater respect for human life, that every heart may honor human life at all stages, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our faith community, that we may strive to have the same mind as Christ as we offer our lives in loving service to others, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish, that through the intercession of St. Mary Magdalene, we may have the faith and courage to follow Jesus through our crosses and difficulties, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the elect and candidates for full communion, that through the celebrations of Holy Week, they may enter more deeply into the mystery of God's unconditional love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are suffering, especially Al, Kenneth, and James, that God will help and sustain them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, that they may now be at peace with God in heaven, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Great and good God, we give you thanks and praise for all of your gifts and graces. Lord, we ask that you please hear and answer these and all of our prayers, for we make them all through Christ our Lord.
Oh, sacred heads of mine.
pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by the sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
the mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Mary Magdalene, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope and Earl, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you, and your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we now dare to say, Our Father,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us
this day our daily bread,
and forgive
us our trespasses,
as we forgive
those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer one another the sign of peace.
Take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Sins of the world.
Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only say a word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Ooh.
Those bringing communion to the sick and homebound, please come forward. May you who bring the Lord to our brothers and sisters go as with God's blessing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for just a quick moment. You may have seen on our way in that there are Holy Land artifacts for sale, and to tell us more about that, here's Esperanza.
Good morning. First, I would like to thank Father for giving us the opportunity to arrive here today and speak about the situation in the Holy Land. My name is Esperanza, a Christian representative from Bethlehem, and representing all of Christians in Bethlehem and some areas in Jerusalem in a noble cause mission to help explain the terrible situation in our area and to sell the beautiful olive wood articles of those remaining Christians in the Holy Land. The Christian population in the Holy Land is dropping at alarming rates. 40 years ago, we were more than 60%. Today, we are less than 1.3%. Since the apartheid wall has been built, many Christian families are isolated behind the wall, leaving them with little to no option of making a living. For these families, the most important source of income has always been the sale of olive wood handicrafts to pilgrims and tourists. That income has dried up in recent years due to the political conflict in the area, with great implications for the Christian families. The building of the wall not only prevented the sale of olive wood crafts, it prevented more Christian workers from reaching their jobs, students from attending schools, farmers from reaching their own lands, and the sick from reaching hospitals. And most importantly, it prevented the Christians from entering and praying in Jerusalem. Since the coronavirus, the selling of the olive wood handicrafts have been greatly impacted, not only here in the United States, but in Bethlehem as well. There has been a great lack of tourism overseas, as well as the shutdown here in America, which affected being able to go to churches and sell the olive wood handicrafts. Due to the lack of business, the religious olive wood handicrafts have been rotting. Therefore, all the hard work and time put into creating them is going to waste. We understand times are tough for everyone. We ask you to purchase anything small or big if possible. Thank you and God bless you. Also, we have a good news too. We accept credit, checks, and cash. Thank you.
Thank you, Esperanza. And please do see their table. They got a ton of great stuff. They make great Easter gifts for your favorite pastor or anybody else in your life, for that matter. So please focus, Father Paul. Okay, here we go. There's a couple other things going on in the gathering space along with the Holy Land sale. The Knights of Columbus are selling Tootsie Rolls like they do every year, so please do see them on your way out as well. We are entering into Holy Week, which gives us the Triduum, which is Holy Thursday, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, and obviously leading into Easter. So we've got a number of different things happening. The Mass of the Lord's Supper on Holy Thursday is at 7 o'clock p.m. Good Friday, we're going to have Stations of the Cross at 2 o'clock, leading right into the Liturgy of the Passion at 3, and then a Tenebrae service at 8. Our Easter Vigil service on Holy Saturday starts at 8:30, and then our normal Sunday schedule for Easter Sunday of 9 and 11. If you're here at 9 and 11 on Easter, you will see some people that you do not recognize. This is a good thing. And I know that this is a busy day and you're going to be stressed out about all the stuff that you have to do after Mass, and you got people coming over and you're going to be impatient and maybe a little bit grumpy. Like, I get it. But this is a moment, right, where we can actually invite Jesus into the lives and hearts of our brothers and sisters who aren't here much of the time. Right? We have this incredible opportunity to allow that grace, allow the Holy Spirit to touch them in that way. And so please, I know it's a stressful time, it's going to be kind of a chaotic zoo. Please, if nothing else, just ask the Holy Spirit to touch your heart and to touch their hearts as we approach Easter, understanding that, again, all of our hope is in these celebrations. Speaking of Easter Vigil, we still do need some food and volunteers for the Easter Vigil reception. For everybody who's coming into the church, there's a small reception after the Easter Vigil. Please, if you're interested in that, especially if you're coming to the vigil anyways, please do take a look at that. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.